Hello and welcome to the first in a series of deep dives into the songs written by the Bay City Rollers. And I'm going to try and do this on an album by album. And I haven't even checked ahead, but I think we can grab four songs off of each album to show their progress as songwriters. And the reason I'm doing this is that I did a video a long time ago that was very popular about the band, but I didn't actually play any of their music in it because I didn't understand exactly how YouTube worked. And as it turns out, I can include their music in my videos. And so I'm going to do my best to edit in the music and discuss each song that they wrote, far from each album. You know, we're not going to cover every single song they ever wrote. And we're going to discuss their songwriting and how it progresses. But there are some other things to also talk about. So let's get into, well, first of all, I want to say, for the first five albums, I'm going through this CD set here. Now, this is from Arista, and it has the first five albums on it, but unfortunately doesn't have Strangers in the Wind, doesn't have Elevator, and doesn't have Vox. And what else do we expect from Arista? Because they did not promote those albums in the first place, right? So they continue with not promoting some very good albums. But having said that, this CD set sounds great, which is important to me, you know. There's good dynamic range in it, and the mastering for CD is very good. So you can't go wrong with it. But we're starting with this first album, and we're talking about the songwriting. So, of course, we have stuff like Shang-A-Lang on here. And I don't mean to say that I don't care about that stuff, but I'm not as interested in that stuff, you know? I'm interested in what the band was actually writing at the time. And there's a few things to take into consideration about the band at this point in time when they were recording this album. First of all, when they were performing under Martin and Coulter, who were writing a bunch of the songs on here and also who were producing this, even before the album came out, the A sides and the B sides of the singles were always Martin and Coulter songs. The Rollers were not allowed to have even a B side. Okay, that's one thing. The other thing is that the Bay City Rollers did set up at some point in time, now I'm not sure if it's around Rollin or maybe it's after, this kind of thing where they had a bucket for songs that they had written, they had royalties coming in, and those royalties were shared evenly throughout the band. And I think the manager also got a portion of that as well. And this fascinates me because I try to think, why would they do that? Now, one reason you might do that is to say, listen, let's support anyone writing songs in the band because we all profit from it. You know, maybe that was the concept. That blew up over time because, you know, we'll get into this later. Certain band members did not want the band writing songs, right? There's another thing that happens, and that is that discussion about with the Faulkner Wood combination of songwriters. What was written by Eric? What was written by Woody? And two things that came out later on was that Eric was saying, you know, Tam was advising Woody not to write songs with me. This is later on. This is not in the very early days. And then there's another thing where Les in his book is constantly attacking Eric's songwriting. And that leads me to believe that Eric was pushing a lot of these songs and Eric is writing a lot of these songs. This is a little bit later on. This is, we're talking early here. And I think at this point in time, Eric and Woody, and probably for the next record as well, are working together to write songs. So let's start talking then about the songs. What I find very fascinating is that the songs they wrote on this first album, first of all, they're a bit more stripped down. You know, if you look at songs like Remember, there's huge things going on there, right? That's one thing. So they're stripped down, but they're also, two of them are acoustic songs primarily. And we'll get into on the next album, there's more acoustic stuff that's even more fascinating. To me, it's very fascinating what they're doing on the next album, right? And another thing that comes up is, you know, who's playing on what on here. Now, so the best information I have, and this is something where I was somewhat accurate on my first video and maybe a bit off, and also I had some tongue-in-cheek comments. But let's get down to it. According to Eric, the Rollers were playing on the songs they wrote themselves on this album. And I would add to that, at the very least, they were playing on the songs that they wrote themselves. And the reason I say that is that there's some cover songs on here too. So who was playing on the cover songs? But then add on to that, the version of Saturday Night that appears on here sounds like it uses tapes from earlier sessions. Nobby Clark has said that he believes his voice is in the chant on the album, okay? And he wasn't even in the band at that point in time. Now, Nobby has said some really nasty things about me, I understand, but I think that he's honest about this. I believe that what he speaks is the truth, and my ears tell me that this could be the case. And I know in Eric's book, the first book that he has so far, that he describes going into the studio to record that original 45 of Saturday Night, right? But the point is, I'm not playing those songs. I'm not playing Saturday Night. I'm not playing Shang-A-Lang. I'm playing the songs that they wrote themselves. And according to Eric, yes, we played on those songs, you know. And I'm sure it's because the producers were like, we're in control of the stuff that we write. This is where we're going to make our money because we own the royalties for the songwriting on this. Let the band do what they're doing with their stuff. That makes perfect sense. And the one exception might be that sometimes, apparently, Derek couldn't make it because he has asthma and was dealing with that and did have some difficult times. Okay, so that's out of the way. With the next album, we'll talk more about who plays on everything, and it becomes very important. And it's a sticky point for me, and I'm sick of hearing about it from certain other people. But let's listen to their first tune that they wrote on their first album, and it's called Angel Angel.
She's gonna take your love and keep you hanging on.
Okay, so that was Angel Angel, and that is a 5-chord song, roughly. I was just trying to play along with it on my guitar. And an interesting thing is that it has a 7-chord. So the B is a 7-chord on there. But what that says is that it is a very traditional kind of rock and roll song. But what makes it special is the interplay between the voices. And I feel stupid now because I remember I was on the radio and I talked about it being Woody and Eric singing, but it's Les and Eric singing. And there's this interplay between the voices. And knowing how little time they had and knowing how little respect was given to their songwriting, it really makes me wonder how they managed to get this out the door so quickly. But, you know, we also forget how much energy we had when we were young. So if we had a little bit of time, we could accomplish a lot when we're young, right? And that's exactly what they did with this song. I think it's a great tune. I like that it's stripped down. It doesn't need anything added onto it. It's about the guitars and the vocals. And that one is not a acoustic song. I was saying how they had some acoustic songs on here. And someday it would be very nice to actually interview Eric and talk about why there were some acoustic songs. And this one in particular, I would love to talk to him about. Listen to the chords on here. It's nice bossa nova chords. Listen to the guitar solo on here on the acoustic guitar. I want to get into Eric's mind and talk to him about this. I doubt it'll ever happen. It would be fantastic. So here's a little bossa nova track from their first album called Just a Little Love. So that was Just a Little Love, and you know, this has been a favorite song of mine for so many years. totally glossed over. Anyone that wasn't an actual fan of the Bay City Rollers that didn't go out and pick up this record have no concept that that song even exists. And I think a lot of people were so biased against them that even if they did hear it, they would have said it was trash, but without actually listening to it. It's got some excellent chord combinations. It's got some excellent vocals. The melody line shows maturation. At that point in time, they were mature enough to be writing those melody lines. And melody lines, I think, I'm starting to learn anyway, is the hardest part. I mean, there are so many songs out there that only use two chords that just have excellent melodies. You can look at Fleetwood Mac for that, right? So anyway, I love that song. I love, and it can only really truly be an acoustic song to be great. And they did a great job with it. And I have to say that even though the producers were focused on their music, the songs that the Rollers wrote were produced very well. And there's excellent production on there. The bass line is exceptional. It's exceptional. I learned that bass line, I think, 2 years ago, and I just played it over and over and over for days, just appreciating how great it was. Okay, so we're going to move on to the next one, and I'll talk about it afterwards. This one's called Ain't It Strange, once again, off of their first album. Okay, so that was Ain't It Strange, and listen to all those acoustic instruments there. You've got Alan playing accordion on there. I think a mandolin shows up for a while. You've got acoustic guitars, and then you have the band singing over top of this. Incredible stuff in many ways when I hear this, and I'm going to talk more about this on the second album. In many ways, this song to me encompasses who the Bay City Rollers were at the time and what made them exceptionally special, because their roots from where they were coming from was making it onto the album. That's my opinion of it. Some of their roots were making it onto the album, and that's what makes it so special. And it goes even further on a few tracks on the next album, and then they become a rock and roll band after that, and things change dramatically. I've read people saying that they felt that the Bay City Rollers were taken away from them when they left Scotland. And I can kind of understand it when you hear the first two albums. Some of the acoustic music on there is some of the stuff that I think these people would have fallen in love with, and it disappeared. It really did disappear, you know. And I'm not saying that the music didn't get better and progress, but this was a very special time, and that was a very special song that they recorded. And there are more on the next album, and I can't wait to talk about those. Anyway, the songwriting on this is in many ways very straightforward, and the song ends in a very straightforward way. But when you're dealing with essentially folk music is what they're kind of heading towards here, you do that. You don't go off and do a 20-minute piano solo or introduce synthesizers, you know? That's the way it is. So we have one more song to listen to. There Goes My Baby. This is... You know, I think they only wrote four songs on the first four albums, so I guess four is the magic number for us. There Goes My Baby. This is more of a traditional doo-wop slash rock and roll type song. Let's take a listen to this.
There goes my baby.
Okay, so that's our last song, and let's talk about it a little bit. I introduced it, it's got a little bit of a rock and roll slash doo-wop thing, but then they've got the thing going on with, I assume there's like bongos going on there and stuff, and then there's like a spoken word section. And what I find fascinating about it is it's a little bit of a kind of fabricated, okay, we are a band that is about, you know, the girls being in love with us, and we have to introduce this and that into the song. But it's written by Eric and Woody, right? And so, and like I was saying, they did not have a lot of time. Like, time was of the essence. Bell was like, we're making a record now because Remember was a hit. And originally Nobby was on that. And then they had, he quit the band. And so Les had to record vocals over it. And then they had to get this record out. Because this is the thing with pop music. You got to strike while the iron's hot. And so they had this song. They wrote this song. And they're kind of like, let's be honest. At this point, they're actually playing a little bit of a boy band thing. We're a bit of a boy band. And they're recording this, but they do a good job of it. And the fact is this, that's not an easy thing for some young kids to do. You don't, you know, no. How were they trained in this? They weren't. They weren't trained in this at all. And so they did a decent job. Not my favorite song on the album, of course. They did an excellent job for what they had to do. And so to end, let's put this into perspective, you know. Marvin Gaye with What's Going On, and then Stevie Wonder with I think he had three or four great albums in a row. Music was changing dramatically, and of course there were very substantial and incredible songwriters out there. This music is a little bit simple in comparison, but it's good, and it hit a nerve with people somehow, right? And this is the kind of thing that you really can't, it's kind of intangible how it happens. We don't even know. You know, AI is trying to figure it out. They had some really decent songs on that first album that they've never received the respect for them, because, you know, producers obviously want their songs to become the singles, and so people never heard them. But, you know, luckily, when I was young, the Rollin album was released here in Canada, and we had it in the car, and I got to hear all the songs. And three of those were my favorite songs on that 8-track. And I was very disappointed when the Bay City Rollers compilation album came out, and they weren't on there. And my anger started at a very young age. So anyone that thinks they can tame me now, well, I've been angry for a long time. Anyway, I hope people enjoyed this. It's going to get deeper and deeper and deeper as we go on through all of these albums. There's something special about these albums. Like I say, it's intangible. But we're trying to get down to the roots of it to try to understand what magic there is that makes us love this band so much. Have a good night, and thanks for watching.